أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله عما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فلا أقسم بمواقع النجوم وإنه لقسم لو تعلمون عظيم إنه لقرآن كريم في كتاب مكنون لا يمسه إلا المطهرون تنزيل من رب العالمين صدق الله المولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم Alhamdulillah, my dear respected brothers, sisters, and elders in Islam, we are grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal who has granted you and I another opportunity to gather for the remembrance of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala praises those that remember Allah. Now imagine how unique that statement is. That not only is Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala giving you and I an opportunity to come for the remembrance of Allah, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala praises those people that remember Allah in the Quran. So Allah is the one that's blessing us. Then Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala on top of that is giving us reward for the blessings that Allah gave to begin with. So understand that being able to sit in a gathering where Allah's name is being presented and we are talking about the deen of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, it is a blessing that comes from Allah and it is a blessing that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala himself celebrates for us to be a part of. So we thank Allah Azza wa Jal for giving us the opportunity to gather for Yawm al-Jum'ah for the dhikr of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. We say Alhamdulillah. Now last week, we were speaking about spending time and learning about the Quran a little bit more. Spending time and learning about the Quran a little bit more. Because as Muslims and as people who are trying our best to understand and to live the life of being a proper Muslim, right? And living in the world that we live today, unfortunately, our attention span is very, very limited, right? Our attention to things is very limited. So similarly, when we see something occurring, we immediately move to that, right? And we know that social media plays a huge part in this kind of deterioration of focus, this deterioration of being able to think and sit and do something, you know, from start to finish without getting distracted. I talk about a scenario where let's say we are about to pray salah and your phone is ringing. And your phone is ringing. It's vibrating or it's ringing. Immediately, you're in the process of praying salah, but your mind could be on 30 other things that's happening. You could be wondering, who's calling me? Is it from home or is it from work? If it's from work, then I have to make sure I need to go and take care of this. Or maybe I didn't do this yesterday, that's why they're calling me. If it's from home, maybe we need milk or we need eggs or we need cheese. Yes or no? Now we don't even know who called, but our mind is automatically going and moving into a different direction. So unfortunately, the way that we live our life today, the distractions of the dunya, Allah Himself calls out in the Quran. The innama al-hayatu dunya la'ibun wa lahu. The Quran describes the situation that you and I are experiencing that stops us from reading the Quran, subhanallah. The Quran itself is describing that verily this life, allowing it to drive yourself, your mind, your intent, your work, if you let this world drive your actions, drive your goals, drive what you want to do, drive the direction you want to go, then all of this life is going to be a distraction away from the reality that this life is temporary. This life is temporary. This world is temporary. This existence is temporary. Allah says in Surah Al-Mulk, and we've covered this many times, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. I've created the situations of death and life. I've created these institutions so that using these two knowledges, these two pieces of information, that you will die and that you will have life, that you may restructure your life. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Use these two pieces of information so that you may do the best of deeds. Who's going to do the best of deeds? Those that pay attention to the fact that we will die and that we'll be resurrected. Or that we've been given life. Those that remember Allah, remember the temporary construct of this world, they will be the ones that will focus their actions, their deeds, not just on the material and dunya portion, but they will focus on al-akhirah. Al-kayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'da al-maut wal 'ajizu man atba'a nafsahu hawa wa tamanna 'ala Allah. Is it the intelligent one is the one who what? He invests not just only in the world, but his investments are for al-akhirah. He's not looking at Bitcoin. He's not looking at Dogecoin. He's not looking at the S&P 500. He is looking at what I can invest in that my Allah says will have the greatest of return in Al-Akhirah. Because why? The life of Al-Akhirah is the reality and the life. Where you go in Al-Akhirah is a never-ending place. Now you and I can choose. Do I want to move to Florida? Do I want to move to New York? Do I want to move to Mexico? Do I want to move back home to X, Y, and Z country? We can make that decision. If it doesn't work out, what happens? We can move right back. But this life and what you and I attain is limited. The time is limited. The resources are limited. And once you and I have expended all of the limits, all of the things that Allah has given, and we make that transition to Al-Akhirah, when we are given our book of deeds, there is no going back. Whatever is in your kitab and whatever is in your future in Al-Akhirah, that is the final destination. That is the ending of our story. And the beginning of another story, we make dua that for us, our ending is Jannat al-Firdaws. Say Ameen. Now, we talked about the Quran last week and the fact that we should spend more time. One of the questions that came up is, why should we study the Quran? What does the Quran, something that was revealed 1400 years ago, plus, why does that Quran have any relativeness to today's time? If we go back and we find a book that is available 1400 years ago and we bring it today, are we going to make it applicable? So why are we doing that with the Quran? What makes the Quran unique? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this explanation is given in the Quran as well. That this Quran, in Surah Ali Imran, at the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions that this kitab, this book that we have, it has the ayat, it has the constructs of guidance, and there are also mutashabihat, things that you and I will not understand. Things that you and I will not understand from the Quran. But we should always go back to the clear statements of the Quran for clarification. The Quran itself tells us that you will be confused by parts of the Quran. It is not because the Quran is wrong, it is because you don't understand. It's because you don't understand. You don't have the construct, you don't have the ability to perceive what Allah has given. Right? Last week we spoke about the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that we have created the skies and they are a form of protection for us. They are a form of protection for us. Now 1400 years later, after these ayat were revealed, right? We now know that the atmosphere, the actual layers of the ozone, that there are multiple layers and each of these layers have its own purpose. And they have its own level of protection that it grants. Some of them, they contain the gases of the earth, maintained within them. Others, they filter the light that is coming from the sun, so it does not become too intense and everything on the earth dies. It also makes the earth, the area, the sphere around the earth, the surface of the earth, in a relative amount of temperature where life can survive. Not too cold so that all water freezes over, but not too hot so that everything is turned into mist. Do we understand, yes or no? Allah says this 1400 years ago. In the Quran, there are linguistic miracles. One of the things that you and I need to understand is the Quran was not in book format. The Quran did not come down with the book and mashallah, the covers and the bindings and written in gold, or written and the names of Allah are in red for those of us that see the mushafs or the indications of the harakat. No, this is not the Quran. This is a representation of the kitab, the tilawat of the Quran. The Quran came in a verbal discussion. In a verbal discussion, a verbal revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, to put that in context, I've been speaking for the last 7 or 8 minutes. Yes or no? Yes. How many of what I have said have been mistakes? How many things did I slip up on? How many times as I'm telling you certain things, maybe my English wasn't good, or maybe my scientific fact was wrong, or maybe I'm saying it in a way where it's not applicable? There are probably a few, yes or no? If not, constantly I'm making mistakes, yes or no? This is a verbal transmission. This is a verbal transmission. Now understand, I came prepared with some notes. Not verbatim now, but even if I was to read word for word what I am about to tell you, I will still make mistakes because I will have mistakes in the things that I've written down. Yes or no? The Quran was a verbal transmission of the direct words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without a single mistake in the tense, in the verb, in the adjective, in the noun, in the way that the sentence is structured or the paragraphs are combined or how the Quran from top to bottom is structured. Not a single mistake is presented. That is the Quran. There was no revisions to the Quran. Do not think that when the ayat came down, that there were some revisions. Oh, well, this portion of the word doesn't, you know, rhyme with the other. This part of the Quran, well, what about this part? No. 23 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down ayat and verses. Sometimes complete surahs were revealed. And as they are coming down, there are cases where a surah was started and it was paused. And later on, Allah Azza wa Jal revealed ayat that were added to the end of the surah. And then more ayat were revealed and they were in the middle of the surah. We know the example because why? Because the main, the primary, the last complete ayah, I mentioned this last week as well, the last complete verse that was revealed in the Quran is not the last ayat of the Quran. It's not min al-jinnati wa nas. We know this, yes or no? We know this, yes or no? It's not even the last ayah in the surah that it's in. It's not even the last ayah of the surah that it's in. The last complete ayah is found in Surah Al-Baqarah. It's towards the end of the surah. And Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَّا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. Fear the day when you will return back to your Allah. And on that day you'll be given exactly what you have earned and no one will be done injustice upon. That's the last ayah. Now imagine the revelation, the linguistical beauty. Understand, today in our time, we have many people that want to degrade the Muslims, yes or no? They want to attack the Muslims for various different things, yes or no? There are so many different ambiguities and many, many things that they'll say, oh, this is attached to Islam. Islam is a bad religion. They do this, they do this. Yes or no? Very rarely will you find someone to come and say that Islam's linguistics in the Quran is wrong. The language of the Quran is wrong. There are a couple of people that have written books, but for 1400 years, they've been proven wrong over and over and over. So much so that the Arabic language, the Fusha, the language itself is structured around the language of the Quran. The sentence structure, the verbology, using the causations of words, Sarf and Nahu, all of that is constructed so that it may match or come close to the way the Quran tells us language is. That's the beauty of the Quran. Understand this as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ وَرَبَّكَ 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 فَكَبِّرْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. Glorify your Lord, for those of us that know Arabic and that have heard this part of the speech before, you know that in English, this is called a palindrome. It's called a palindrome, like race car. Like what? Race car. If you spell race car backwards, it's still race car. It's still race car. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, right? رَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ is a palindrome. No matter which way you look at it, Allah says, glorify me. No matter what you see, no matter what your understanding of the world is, no matter your delineation, your country, your language, your social status, your economic position, no matter who you are, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, glorify Allah. You have no other option. There is no every which way around it. It's the only option that you have once you realize the an'amat of Allah. This Quran also confirms the stories of the past and is consistent upon those stories. Now, we know that in order for you to be a part of a tribe, in order for you to be a part of a tribe, right? Who are you connected to that is connected to the tribe? Your father. Your lineage goes through who? I can't hear you. Your lineage goes through? Your father. You are considered a tribe, right? A part of the tribe of whoever your lineage from your father's side is. That's how it works. Yes or no? Yes. That's how it works. In the Quran, when Musa alayhi salam talks, he says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ I'm not going to finish the ayah because that's outside of the point. Musa alayhi salam, when he speaks to his people, what does he say? يَا قَوْمِ Oh my people. Oh my people. Because why? Musa alayhi salam, his father, they were from the tribe of what? Bani Israel, yes or no? Yes or no? In the same context, when Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam, does he have a father, yes or no? Does he have a father, yes or no? Isa alayhi salam does not have a father. He was of a miraculous birth. He was a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a manufactured product of Allah azza wa jal to show the qudra of Allah, that Allah can create a creation from amongst insan that is brought onto the earth without the use of a man. With Adam alayhi salam, Allah says, I created him from nothing, from no man and no woman. With all of us, Allah created us from one man and one woman, yes or no? Yes or no? Yes. With Hawa radiallahu ta'ala anha, the wife of Adam alayhi salam, Allah created her from what? From one man, yes or no? The rib of Adam alayhi salam. The only combination that is left is what? For Allah to bring about a creation from a woman without a man. Without a man. And Allah Azza wa Jal showed his qudra by allowing Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam to be born. So he was born and he did not have a father. Look at how he addressed Bani Israel. Isa ibn Maryam, he says, وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى ابْنُ مَرْيَمْ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ when, do you remember the time when Isa ibn Maryam said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ What is the difference between the two? لِقَوْمِ And Ya Bani Israel. Musa alayhi salam is saying, Liqawmi, to my people. Isa alayhi salam is talking and he says, Oh people, I cannot claim you to be my people because why? My lineage does not go through you. I do not have a father. Understand, these are linguistical miracles of the Quran. The language is given by Allah. The people at the time when these ayat were being revealed, they were some of the best linguists, some of the best poets, some of the best storytellers on the planet in terms of the Arabic language, yes or no? They could not come and say that the Quran was a mistake. They could not come and say that there are mistakes in the way that the Quran is talking. Even in the Quran, harakat, just the way that we pronounce things, it's important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Hafiz Siam read this in Taraweeh this year, mashallah, may Allah bless him. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ For those of you that know Arabic, you know what the importance of the Dhamma at the end and the Fatha on Allah means. It means, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ Those that fear Allah. So Allah is the subject of the fear. He is the subject of the fear. min ibadihil, from amongst the servants of Allah, al-ulama'u. This u, if you change it around, if you put these to the opposite sides, it makes an error that causes you to have kufr unless you do tawbah and you fix yourself. Yes or no? Simple, just by changing the harakat of two letters changes the meaning of an entire verse. This is the Quran, infallible, untouchable. This is the kitab that is given to you and I. This is the book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps telling us, wa'tasimu bihablillahi jami'a. Come together, put away your differences, put away your arguments, put away all of the things that are causing you to fracture and fragment. Put those things behind you. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. Allah says, ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, waja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'il lita'arafu. I am Allah. I'm the one that created you, O insan. O humanity. Allah doesn't say, O Muslims. Because this doesn't just apply to the Muslims. This is humanity at large. Allah says, I am the one. I've created you from one man and one woman. From one man and one woman. You are all interconnected. You are all connected through a family system back to Adam alayhi salam and Hawa radiallahu ta'ala anha. Then Allah says, what? I have made you from amongst different tribes and different nations. In another part of the Quran, وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ, Allah says, I've given to you distinctions in your speech and in your color. I'm the one that did that. I, Allah, am making you into all of these different groups. Not so that these groups can war and fight against one another for supremacy. Because why? Allah says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honorable in the eyes of Allah is the one that humbles himself in front of Allah by fearing Allah. You think you're a good person. You think your family are good people. Your nation is a good nation. Your tribe, your nationality, they are good. Put them to the test. How humble are you in front of Allah Azza wa Jal? My dear brothers and elders in Islam, this Quran, the final thing I'll mention, one of the ulama, he was explaining this in a bayan, and alhamdulillah, we've been reading these ayat for ages, and Allah reveals these things and informs us through so many different ways. The alim, he was explaining, he says, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fas'alu, Qari Sahib knows, fas'alu ahla dhikr in kuntum la ta'alamun. Now, the alim, he says, that look at how unique Allah has made this statement. In the Quran, we have the term Ahl Kitab, yes or no? Yes. Ahl Kitab means the people of the book. What book? The Injil and the Torah. They are referencing people of the book. But Allah also makes reference in the Quran, right? مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا. Allah is talking about the carriers, those that carry knowledge, yes or no? So there are variations of people Allah talks about that have knowledge, that contain knowledge. In this ayah, when you are confused about something, Allah says, فَاسْأَلُوا, go and ask أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. Go and ask the people of remembrance. Not the people of knowledge, meaning what? There's a difference between learning how to swim from your book and actually going and being able to swim in a pool or a lake, yes or no? Yes or no? A person who has a PhD in a kitab, in a book of swimming, if I take him and put him inside the lake, what are the chances that he will actually be able to swim? Slim, right? Because why? He is not somebody who is actively practicing whatever it is that they know. This is a container of knowledge, similar to a bookshelf, yes or no? Is a container of knowledge. Allah says, don't go to containers, go to the people that are actively doing the work. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. Go to the people that are doing the work. They have made it a mission. They are sacrificing their time. This is their job. This is their careers. This is their responsibility. Go to them. Don't seek out a surgeon who has retired from surgery and ask him to do surgery on you. You're going to ask the latest surgeon, the most experienced surgeon in the hospital to say, you know what? When's the last time you did surgery? Yesterday. Cool. I need you to do my surgery for me. Yes or no? Yes. Even in the Quran, the instructions are clear and they clarify. Go and ask the people. Not only do they have knowledge, but they practice their knowledge. Instruction from the Quran, one after the other after the other. This kitab, this book, is what elevates the Muslims above everyone else. But this is also the reason for why we as the Muslim Ummah are suffering. Because why? We have gone far away from the kitab. We've gone far away from the kitab. And our understanding is so limited. Because next time, you and I, for those of us that have an argument with someone, or let's say we have an argument with our spouse, an argument with our... Oh, you don't want to say it now. When you have an argument with your spouse, right? When you have a discussion and you disagree, when's the last time that you said, let's go and read the Quran? Let's allow the Quran to calm us down and let's talk about it that way. Or do we go to our own corners and mumble underneath our breath? And we keep arguing and arguing and Allahu Akbar. The last time you had a question about something, how many of us sat down and said, I'm going to read the Quran and allow that the barakah of the Quran to touch me. For me to read through the ayat of the Quran to see if there's anything in there. For me to sit with an alim, an imam, a sheikh that can guide us to what we need to do. Or do we sit and Google all of our questions? Is it halal to do X, Y, and Z? Subhanallah. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, the reason for why this ummah, this nation is blessed in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and was blessed in the past, even more so than today, and the amount of changes they were able to bring is not even comparable, even though we are more numerous today than they were, is because they were closer to the Quran. It didn't mean they had less problems now. Don't think I'm going to come to Quran and all my problems are going to go away. That's not how it works. It means that when we have stress, when we have depression, when we have financial trouble, when we have questions, when we are second guessing ourselves, when we are in a situation where we don't know what path to take, instead of trying other avenues first, come to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? That anyone, ذكرتني ذكرتك. When you remember me, I remember you. وَإِن نَسِيتَنِي ذَكَرْتُكَ. Allah says, when you forget me, I still remember you. When you're remembering me, Allah says, I am remembering you. And when you forget me, Allah says what? I still remember you. I still remember you. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal for istiqamah, steadfastness. The ability not just to learn about the Quran, but to apply the tilawat of the Quran in our life. Simple question, have we read more Quran in the last week than in the month of Ramadan? Or in the last month? Have we read more Quran? We have not. Quran was being recited. We used to read the Quran or listen to the Quran. How many of us are still doing that now after Ramadan? We need to go back. We need to make our efforts and our time represent our iman, which is what? In Allah and His Rasul and the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah for istiqamah, steadfastness, say ameen. We ask Allah for hidayah, for guidance. All of us needs it, say ameen. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to forgive our shortcomings and sins because all of us make mistakes, say ameen. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to bless us in the best of manners, to forgive us in the best of ways. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to guide us with a nur that is unwavering. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah to grant hidayah to all of the non-Muslims. Say ameen. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to enable us to live and to die with the kalima La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ma alayna illa al-balagh. Few minutes for sunnah inshaAllah.